our service this morning. Take your songbook number 50. Stand with me as we sing, praise Him, praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. This morning, sing that with us. What a wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. Christ has for sin atonement made. What a wonderful Savior. We are redeemed. The price is paid. What a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful Savior. My Jesus, what a wonderful
a wonderful Savior, and I'm thankful to be gathered together with you this morning in God's house, and we're thankful that you're here. I'm going to read you a portion of Scripture out of the book of Psalms, chapter number 147, where the Bible says, "Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God, for it is pleasant and praise is comely. The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcasts of Israel. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. He telleth the number of the stars. He calleth them all by their names. Great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite." He is worthy to be praised. Amen. And so that's our plan this morning as we continue our service. Our choir is going to sing a special, and we just intend to lift his name up this morning, and I hope you'll join in with us. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for gathering each one here today. God, we are in your house to sing praises to you, to lift you up. And God, we pray in doing so that you would draw men to you. And God, through the preaching of your word, through the response of this people, I pray that everything today would honor and glorify you. And God, that you would reach into a soul's life this morning that might be here and they may be lost. I pray today would be the day of their salvation. And God, if there's someone here that they're looking for a church home, a family that they can gather with and be encouraged and be strengthened, God, I pray that they'd find that place right here at Bethany Baptist. May your name be lifted up today in everything that we say and do, and may you be honored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
This morning, 580 burdens are lifted at Calvary. Days are filled with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and drear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. All the cruel cross he suffered, from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will sing this morning before our morning offering. There is a Redeemer, and you know his name? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son. Sing that with us this morning. Time without the instruments playing, just sing that chorus with us. Lift your voice in thanks to the Lord for what he's done. Amen. Thank you, oh my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done.
Amen. One of my favorite quotes of all time is a man named C.T. Studd said that if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, there's nothing too great that he could ask of me. And he asks us for our obedience and faithfulness. And we have this time in the offering to do that. Let's go to him in prayer and ask for his blessing on the offering. Lord, we're grateful for your faithfulness, your goodness to us, Lord, so undeserved. And so abundant. I pray, Father, that as this time comes for our service, Lord, as we give to you according as you've given to us, Lord, that you would take and use and bless and multiply, Father, and great be that you'd be happy and honored with what's given, Lord. And we'll be grateful for the fact that you've given us participation in it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
with laughter. My heart has known your peace. I've traveled far, long, far to go. Because in my heart there is a longing to look upon your face. Where you are is where I want to be.
Thank you, ladies. Appreciate that very much. Let's take our Bibles this morning. Go to Luke chapter number 4. Luke chapter number 4, if you're physically able, I would invite you to stand with me in honor of the reading of God's Word. Luke 4, we're going to begin this morning in verse number 31. Luke 4, verse 31. We'll read down to verse number 37. The Bible says in verse 31, and came down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee, and taught them on the Sabbath day. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. And in the synagogue there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil, and cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold thy peace and come out of him." And when the devil had thrown him in the midst, he came out of him and hurt him not. And they were all amazed and spake among themselves, saying, "What a word is this? For with authority and power he commandeth the unclean spirits, and they come out." And the fame of him went out into every place of the country round about. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in your house this morning. Thank you for the music, how it's already stirred our hearts. And Lord, I'm thankful for this good crowd. I pray now that God, you would just be here in the midst of us as you've promised to be. And God, that you would use this portion of Scripture in the power of the preached Word of God to make a difference in our lives today. Lord, I say it almost every service, but it is impossible for me to know what every individual, what every family, Lord, is going through in this auditorium this morning. So I'm thankful that there is a God who knows exactly where everybody is, knows exactly what they need. And God, through this message, you can communicate and give them help in those areas. And so we're looking forward to what you're going to do this morning. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You may be seated. Interruptions can happen at the absolute strangest of times. You're just going through life, and then all of a sudden something interrupts life. Ever had the power go out in a store or somewhere you're at, and it just shuts everything down? I remember a few years ago, some of you might as well. Brother Tyler Prater was here preaching on a big day, and the power went out, and he preached in the dark. And it kind of threw a damper on the day a little bit. We live in a day and age of technology and cell phones, of course. And you know this, cell phones ring all the time. It's a good day, a good service when we get through without a cell phone going off and someone reminding us, I won't say who, that they're bad to the bone. And have you ever been at a funeral? Had a cell phone go off? I had the most annoying ringtone possible on my phone. One time I thought, this is funny, everybody will laugh at this. And then I went in to pray with somebody before a surgery, and in the middle of the prayer, that annoying ringtone went off, and I decided right then, I'm shutting my ringer off, and I'll never turn it back on. And so if you call and I don't answer, it's because my ringer's off, but hang on, I'll call you right back. Sometimes we have interruptions in church. I was at a guest in a church, and I was sitting in a Sunday school class, and right in the middle of the Sunday school class, I mean, the teacher is teaching, and it's good, and everybody's paying attention, and all of a sudden, I don't know what she did, but my wife hit something on her phone, and Siri came on right in the middle of the lesson and said, I'm sorry, I'm not sure I understand what you said. I kind of turned around and looked at her. Thanks, dear. Thanks for drawing attention to us. I asked several preachers about maybe some interruptions that they experienced in services, and of all of them that I asked, almost everybody had some type of interruption that was about a medical emergency that happened in the middle of the service. But one of the preachers I just texted just said just recently, and they don't know how, but one of the bus kids got loose out of junior church, ran into the main building, and pulled the fire alarm so that everybody knew he was there. Another one talked about how just recently a family that were visiting for the first time brought a small child into services, and literally the entire service let the kid scream and cry and throw a fit and never took the baby out. And he said, you might as well not even had church that day. My favorite was my friend Michael Jones. He is now in Carolina's pastoring, but at one time he pastored in Long Beach, California. And he gave me several illustrations of things that happened there in Long Beach. One, he said, right after the Supreme Court ruling on same-sex marriage, he happened to be preaching from Daniel, where the Bible talked about how Daniel's spirit was troubled. And he just happened to say, you know, with the things that have happened in our country this week, he said, my spirit is also troubled. And right when he said that, a lady stood up on the second row, took out a rainbow flag out of a bag, and began to wave it around and begin to cuss Brother Jones. Yeah, that'll interrupt the service. But that's not my favorite. I can't decide which of these is my favorite. But he said once during a Sunday school class, and a homeless guy somehow snuck into the back baptistry room, and right in the middle of the lesson, cannonballed into the baptistry. And as he was going down, he said, it's time to end it all, and jumped into the baptistry. Did we check the baptistry rooms today? Great. Yeah, I don't know how you keep teaching through that. Said another time, of course, I mean, they're in Long Beach, they're L.A. He said they had a homeless man, and every time he came to church, he caused problems, and he always liked to sit on the front row. And so he came in one service. He made his way down. He sat down in the front row. So Brother Jones went to a deacon and said, "Hey, we can't let this happen. This man is going to mess up services. So here's what I want you to do. Go down and just ask him to come back and sit by you, and maybe you'll be able to keep him from being an interruption." So the deacon went down and very kindly said, "Hey, why don't you come back and sit next to me?" And the guy said, "No." He said, no, just come back and sit next to me." And the guy began to get irate, and he began to scream, and he began to point at the deacon, and he says, "No, I'll sit where I want to sit." And then he said, "In fact, I want to sit up there." And he pointed at the chair on the platform where Brother Jones would normally sit. And just as he said that, he made a run for the platform and for that chair, grabbed a hold of it, and wouldn't let anybody stop him. So all the deacons had to come down. They picked him up and was trying to carry him out of the auditorium. And while they're carrying him out of the auditorium, another man in the church got mad because of the way they were handling this man and began to scream out, "Put him down, he's a human being." And so needless to say, it was quite an interruption. In our text today, Jesus is preaching in a synagogue. And there's quite an interruption that takes place. The text begins in verse 31, and he says, "And Jesus came down to Capernaum, a city in Galilee, and he taught them on the Sabbath day." Capernaum is really quite a city there, and it became the headquarters, if you would, of Jesus' public ministry. It's the region that Jesus kind of headquartered out of. And when the Bible talks about how he went from synagogue to synagogue, his base would have been there. Synagogues would have been very common in that day. In fact, almost every town would have had a synagogue. That they said that if there were over 10 Jewish men over the age of 12 in any area, that they could organize and have a synagogue. And so this wasn't the place where they would have a sacrifice. No, they would go to Jerusalem to the temple to do this, but rather a place where they would come together to read God's word, to study God's word, to learn about God's word, to pray, and to worship. Remember that the copies of the Word of God were not common in that day. And so it was very rare for anybody at their homes or anybody individually to have a copy of the Word of God. So if they wanted to hear what the Word of God had to say, they would go to these synagogues, which would have portions of Scripture or scrolls of Scripture, and they would go there, and that's where they would learn about the Word of God. And so these services, they would not be led by a priest, but most of the time just an ordinary person in their town, a layman. Or if it happened to be that they had a rabbi that was in the area or a rabbi that would come by, then they would allow that rabbi to speak in the synagogue on that day. And so in my mind, just thinking of a lay person and their lack of the knowledge of the Word of God and just the small part, small groups that would be there at many times, I would just imagine in my mind that these services were not the most exciting. I don't think you came and heard just an awesome duet on the piano and an awesome special and great congregational speaking or congregational singing. I think that these were kind of dry services. So you can imagine the people of Capernaum. They know that the synagogue is meeting on that day, and so they make their way there, and they're probably expecting, you know, some rabbi that's as dry as dust to get up and speak. They showed up, and I'm sure even then, they all had their spots in the synagogue, you know, their seats where they sat. And so they went to their spot, their seat, no one else better sat in it. They sat down, and they were probably looking forward to, well, what some of you are about to enter into, their Sunday morning nap. But then Jesus began to speak. This rabbi was different than every other rabbi that they had heard. This wasn't like all the other speakers they had. As Jesus opened up the scriptures and he began to read, and then he would have set the scriptures down and begin to expound on those scriptures, all of a sudden they realized, wait a second, there's something uniquely different about this man. In fact, he wasn't quoting other authorities. They realized he was the authority. There was, for the first time, as they're sitting there listening, there was something alive about what this man was saying. There was something exciting, something thrilling. He talked to people and he talked about them, about where they lived. He talked about heaven and hell. He talked about heart and the home. He talked about life and death. He hit them in the heart. The Bible says this in verse number 33, and they were astonished. That word astonished means this, that they were struck by a blow. Hey, have you ever been hit where it stuns you? I remember in junior high, I'm just minding my own business, this shy, dorky little kid walking to class, when all of a sudden, somebody come running out of a classroom, swung a door open, and before I could even realize what was happening, I mean, it hit me right in the head and knocked me completely out. The next thing I knew, I was waking up in a classroom with a teacher standing over me saying, "Son, are you okay? Are you okay?" And I'm like, I don't even know where I'm at or who I am. I don't know if I'm okay. Stunned me. You know, sometimes when we come to God's house, the same thing happens. We're coming to God's house and we're expecting that the services are going to go just a certain way and then it's all going to be routine and it's going to go just like it's always gone. But have you ever been in a service where God just reached down and begins to stir your heart and he begins to do something special? Maybe you think it's just going to be a normal service and then God reaches down and does something miraculous in that service and people are saved and lives are changed and just incredible things happen as God works in hearts and lives, and we all sit back and we're kind of astonished, we're kind of stunned, going, man, that's awesome what God did today. I think that's exactly what was happening there. Jesus taught them, the Bible says, as one having authority. His word was with power, his word was with authority, and it stunned them. And so here he is, and he's teaching them on the Sabbath day. And they're all sitting there, and they're amazed how the preaching of the Word of God is at work. When all of a sudden, the service is interrupted. It seems to me that the man was likely there throughout the entire service. But somehow, when Jesus' preaching began to grab hearts and minds, suddenly, just like a man jumping into the baptistry, the demon-possessed man suddenly cries out, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us, thou Holy One of God?" Now, I know that when we read something like this in our day and age, it's very foreign to us. And when we don't like to think about demonic activity, and we don't like to think about people being demon-possessed, it's still a reality in our day. It was more of a reality in that day. It's more of a reality in other countries than it is here. And I don't know that I am an authority enough to tell you why it's different here and why it's different in different times and different places. But I do know that when it comes to demonic activities, there seems to be two ditches or two extremes that people seem to go to. And we need to avoid both. One group of people, they just see demonic activity in everything. Your child messes up over here and you're like, yep, that's the devil in him. Well, maybe not. Maybe he just can't control his flesh. Maybe he's just a rebellious little snot that needs a whooping. I don't know. But it doesn't mean that he's demon possessed. Much of what we blame on the devil is really our flesh, but there are people that go to the extreme and they see the devil and his demonic work in everything. But then there's another group of people that dismiss it altogether. There's some commentators that I've read after, even on this text, that said, well, you know, it really wasn't demon possession. I mean, these people, it was like an epileptic fit, and they just had epilepsy, and that's what it was, and it really wasn't anything more than that. But the Bible distinguishes between illness and demonic activity. I think the Bible knows. And the Bible has way too much to say about demonic activity and demon possession for us just to dismiss it. And so we don't want to go to either extreme. But the point is this morning that this person who's possessed with a devil, he stands up and he begins to cry out. I'm certain that if something like this happened today, that it would wake up even those of you that are the soundest of sleepers. I mean, can you imagine? Right in the middle of the preaching service, this fellow, he just stands up and he blurts all this out. Who is this unclean spirit? We know he's loud. We know he interrupts the service. We know he draws our attention like somebody would if they stood up in the service today and began to scream and yell. But in speaking to Christ, this demonic spirit, he employed two different names, one which expresses some antagonism and the other fear. He starts out and he says, "Thou Jesus of Nazareth, art thou come to destroy us? I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God." The idea of Jesus of Nazareth, that was kind of a mocking term that he used. He understood that the people of that day held Nazareth in very low esteem, and so the Jewish leaders would have mocked the idea that the Messiah would have come out of such a humble beginnings, and so he's trying to belittle Jesus and to make people think less of him. But at the very same time he's doing that, the evil spirit, he knew exactly who Jesus was. Because he called Jesus the Holy One of God. He was fully aware. Even though he was trying to divert attention, he was fully aware that Jesus was of the most divine authority. And though it was the demons that were crying out or the devil that was crying out, I don't want you to get lost in this text and realize that behind the scenes or the fact that behind the demon possession, there was a life of a man that was hurting. The life of a man who was wrecked by the powers of darkness. In fact, the image of this man is not that different in my mind to the image of the other people that would have been in the synagogue that day. Though his situation was different than maybe the others, there were so many similarities to the people that were there that day. Because most everybody there, just like everybody here, would have had some problems. And the problem would have been what one man described as disease of the soul. See, these people showed up to the synagogue that day and their lives were fragmented. They too had many voices within them. Proverbs 19:21 says this: "There are many devices in a man's heart. There are many things that come out of our heart." And so when he cries out and he says, "What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth?" He's showing us there is distance between this individual's life and Jesus. And the fact that he's crying out, it shows that he feels somewhat isolated. It's not, however, just about him. The question is not only for himself, but for all of those in the synagogue that day, because he, again, represented everyone who was experiencing brokenness of life. He is a spokesman for all who feel disconnected from themselves, others, or God. He represents the human condition. Behind the question is, I believe, the unspoken longing and hope that Jesus would say when he cried out and says, "What have you to do with me?" That Jesus would cry out and say, "Everything. I have everything to do with you." These are the words that can begin to put a life back together. See, here's the point, and every time we go through a text like this, sometimes we can get so caught up in the text that we fail to see ourselves in the text. But I want us to see ourselves, because there are some who here today are no doubt asking, "What does Jesus have to do with my situation? What does Jesus have to do with me?" I understand he's a God in the Bible, and I understand who he is, but I don't understand what he can do to help me. How can he help me to be a teenager in the day and age that I'm being a teenager? How can he help with my marriage problems? How can he help with my financial problems? How can he help with me being a single mom? How can he help with the overwhelming pressures of getting a degree? All of the things that we might be going through today. And the answer for this man and the answer for us all is the very same, that Jesus has everything to do with everything. Whatever you're going through today, wherever you are today, if you're sitting here and you're a young person trying to figure out what the next step of your life is, Jesus has everything to do with that. If you're here and you're trying to figure out how to raise kids, Jesus has everything to do with that. If you're trying to figure out the next step in your career, Jesus has everything to do with that. If you're trying to figure out how to beat addiction, Jesus has everything to do with that. He has everything to do with everything. So wherever you are, whatever you're going through today, the question needs to be not, Jesus, what do you have to do with my situation? But the answer needs to be in our heart that, Jesus, I know that you have everything to do with every situation going on in my life. I love Jesus' response. The Bible says in verse 35 that Jesus rebuked him. The word rebuked, it means to put a muzzle on it. Sometimes don't you moms wish you could put a muzzle on your kids? The English equivalent, careful now. I'm just saying the English equivalent to rebuking, to putting a muzzle on it, is this: shut up. Now, you probably don't use those words with your kids, but you've thought it many times. Jesus alone possessed the authority, the inerrant authority, to command this devil. There didn't need to be dialogue. There didn't need to be negotiation. There was no struggle that was necessary. In fact, I think it's interesting that you go back into that culture in that times, and probably even to our day, attempted exorcisms involving various formulas and rituals, they were not uncommon in that day of the New Testament times. However, it's interesting that most of the time, the average person that tried to cast out devils or tried to cast out demons, they produced no real success. One of my favorite stories in all the Bible is in Acts chapter number 19. The Bible's talking about how God's using the Apostle Paul. I mean, everywhere Paul goes, God's at work in Paul's life, and great things are happening. The Bible talks about all these miraculous things that are happening, including that evil spirits went out of people. He was casting out the demons out of people. And so there were people in that day. And the Bible says in verse 13 that certain vagabond Jews, exorcists, that they took upon them to call over them which had evil spirits. So there were a lot of people in that day that would try to do the same thing. And the Bible says that in this time that Paul was doing this and seeing great success, and the time that there was a bunch of other people doing it and not experiencing a lot of success, that there were seven sons of one man by the name of Sceva. He was a Jew. He was a chief priest. And these seven sons, they see this demon-possessed guy, and they cry out, and they try to cast out the devil out of this demon-possessed guy. And they say to this demon-possessed guy, go forth. And the evil spirit answered and said, wait, watch this, to these seven sons, the evil spirit said, Jesus I know, and that Paul I know, but who are you? And the man in whom had the evil spirit was, he leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed them so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. I don't know exactly what that looks like, and I don't want to picture it in my mind. But can you imagine when they got home to dad? What happened to you boys? Yeah. Jesus didn't have that issue. His success rate in casting out devils was perfect. He never failed to cast out the demons he confronted, nor did he have to rely on any special formulas or rituals to do so. He simply issued a command, and the demons obeyed. He said, hold thy peace and come out of him. Luke does not provide any biographical information about this man whom was delivered, and I think that was on purpose. The lack of detail is intentional, because the focus is really not ever to be on this man. It's to be on the one who liberated him, the one who has power to liberate you. So the Bible says in verse 36 that when he did this, they were all amazed. They spake among themselves, saying, what a word is this? For with authority and power he commanded the unclean spirits, and they come out. And the fame of him went out into every place of the country round about. Can you see it? Jesus does this miraculous thing. The crowd begins to buzz with excitement over everything that had happened in church that day. Talk about leaving church and going to dinner at the Golden Corral and talking to people saying, you wouldn't believe what happened at our church today. I mean, they started telling everybody they knew. They'd been stunned. They'd been shocked. They'd been hit with the force of the authority of his teaching, but they had been equally shocked by the power that he exercised over unclean spirits. Well, one that could do this for this man could no doubt do the very same thing in their lives and make a difference in their lives. The one that could change the life of this demon-possessed man could change their life, and he could change yours. And so the Bible says the people were amazed. In other words, they couldn't stop talking about it. You know, news travels fast, especially bad news, doesn't it? We can share something with people all over the world in just seconds. 140 characters or less, we can destroy someone or something in hours. Or we can do something really good. These people saw what Jesus did and they couldn't keep it to themselves. When the God of everything and everyone shows up, lives will be transformed. Others will take notice. And you, when God does that, you can't help but share it with everybody else. Listen, I'm just going to pause here and just give a little commercial. I can't stress the importance of you being in your place in church. When we come together for worship, something unique happens in this place. When we proclaim, when we come to church, we're proclaiming, we're doing what these people do, their response, and they were amazed and they begin to speak. When we come to church and we take notice in what God's doing, we begin to proclaim to our kids that God is more important than games and errands and hobbies and entertainments. When we come to church, we demonstrate to our neighbors that God is our authority. We are reminded there are others on this journey of faith with us. We put ourselves in positions to hear and to experience God. I love church because this is where God chooses to meet with us. And when the God of everything and everyone shows up, lives are transformed. It's in this place that God wants to take the angry person and make them kind. God wants to take the unfaithful person and make them faithful. God wants to take the drunkard and make them sober. God wants to take the unsubmissive and make them submissive. The vulgar to decent, the impatient to patient, the weak to strong, the selfish to selfless. God wants to do all that in our place. We just got to be here to see it. I'm just saying that there are some that didn't show up to the synagogue that day and they regretted it. And there's sometimes God just meets with us in such miraculous ways. And I hate it that you would miss it. So let's draw some application here. There might be someone in this service today, and though you did not disrupt the service, there's something inside of you that you are hiding. There's something inside of you that needs to get out. Maybe it is that you're sitting here amongst a bunch of people on their way to heaven, and the reality is you know you're going to hell. Maybe you're sitting here and amongst people whose marriages appear to be strong and yours is falling apart. Maybe you're sitting here amongst those who are excited about the things of God while he seems like he's a million miles away in your life. Maybe you're sitting here amongst people who are smiling and seem so happy while any smile you muster is nothing more than the facade of and a way of hiding the deep pain that you carry day in and day out. And it might be that you're sitting here in this auditorium this morning and you came in here wondering, what does Jesus have to do with me? What difference can Jesus make in my broken marriage, in my broken heart, in my broken life? What difference can Jesus make? Who is this Jesus of Nazareth? Who is this Holy One of God? What does this sermon have to do with me? I'm telling you, this sermon has everything to do with you. Because he alone is the answer to life's problems. He alone can rebuke and dismiss the hidden issues of life. When lives of sinners intersect with the authority and the power of the Savior, lives are changed. And that's exactly what he wants to do today. Jesus has everything to do with everything in your life. One of the biggest mistakes, listen to me, one of the biggest mistakes that you can make is to walk out here and go, well, Jesus doesn't care about that. Oh, friend, he does care about that. Jesus doesn't care about me and the little problems. No, Jesus does care about you. And he does care about everything you're struggling with. Sometimes, especially as Baptists, we can get this reputation for being so hard and so against sin that God is just an angry God waiting to zap you down. And yes, God is a holy and righteous God, and He is a holy God. And I've highlighted like four scriptures in my Bible this week that just deal with the fact that He is a consuming fire. But He loves you. And He's merciful, and He's also gracious. He cares about every struggle that you're going through. He cares about what you have to deal with day in and day out. He cares about your loneliness. He cares about your frustration. He cares about your depression. He cares about your eating disorder. He cares about that rebellious child that you have. He cares about all of the things you're going through in life. And He has everything to do with that. And He didn't just bring you here today. Just like He didn't bring those people there that day just to come in and go out and go, well, check mark, went to the synagogue. No, they came that day and His desire was to change lives and to help people. And His desire today is the very same, to change your life and to help you. So if you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you're not 100% certain you're on your way to heaven, I'm telling you, today you need to get that settled and know for sure you're on your way to heaven. Whatever else the struggle is, Jesus cares about it. Why don't you let the God that has everything to do with everything do something about your everything? Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to pray for you. I really can't imagine that someone would show up to a service like this and come in and go out and not be changed, or come in lost and go out lost, come in not knowing they're on their way to heaven and go out not knowing they're on their way to heaven. No, I want it to be just the opposite. If you came in here today and you're like, I'm not 100% certain I'm on my way to heaven, when you leave these doors, I want you to know for sure you're on your way to heaven. We have so many people up here in the front that have their Bibles, several staff members and others, and they'd love nothing more than to take the Word of God and show you how you can know for sure you're on your way to heaven. If you're here today and you don't know 100% certain that if you used to die right now, you'd go to heaven. Nobody's looking around, but I do want to pray for you. With nobody looking around, if you say, preacher, I don't know for sure if I was to die right now, I'd go to heaven, but would you just pray for me? I want to get that settled. With nobody looking around, just slip your hand up and hold it there for just a second. Just hold it there for just a second. Thank you. Thank you. I know it takes courage to acknowledge that and raise your hand. I wonder, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I wonder all the issues that are going on in this place today. Struggles at work, struggles with the business, struggles at home, struggles at school, struggles in relationships, struggles in your spiritual life. I mean, your spiritual life is on a downward spiral. I mean, it is going out of control, and it seems like with every passing week, God seems farther and farther and farther away. Aren't you thankful that He likes to meet us right where we are? He likes to do a work. That man left that day with his life changed, and so can you. Father, I pray for this invitation. I pray for anybody that would be here that's not saved, that you'd save them. I pray for the remainder of us, that God, we would come to the God that has everything to do with everything. And Lord, we would allow you to change our lives today. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Would you stand with me? So we have a time of invitation. God spoke to your heart today. I want to invite you during this invitation, as Brother Gerald leads us in song, to respond. As we sing, you come. so thankful you're in God's house today. Visitors, make sure you stop by and let us get to know you a little bit before you leave. Fill out a card. I have a gift for you. And we're going to have some announcements, and then Brother Jackie Dalrymple is going to close us in prayer.
If you're new here or have questions about baptism or how to become a member of our church, please stop by the Welcome Centers in the lobby. Tonight at 6:15, we'll have Hector and Erica with us for the evening service. Right after, we will have a wedding shower for Jonathan and Kaylee.
The teens have a restaurant takeover at Slim Chickens on the 26th. Our Easter cantata is just right around the corner. Be praying now about who God wants you to invite. Easter Sunday will be a full day. Sunday school will not meet, and our morning service will begin at 10:30. And in place of our regular evening service, all members will take part in the Lord's Supper at 5 o'clock. Our evening service will begin at 6:15. We'll see you soon.
Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to Thee this morning, Lord, just thanking You for being able to come into Your house of worship, just being able to hear Your word preached directly from the Bible. Lord, I pray that You'll just be with each one that's here today. We just thank You for all the visitors You've sent our way. I pray that You'll just keep everybody safe as we go to our homes. Bring us back tonight, Lord. All these things we ask in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.